Hello, Professor Ian. Welcome to ITC. Welcome to the GeoHero channel. What are we going to talk about today?
I'm a geologist. I'm interested in geology, and that is something that maybe many of the viewers are either unfamiliar, or it's stones, rocks, you know, something very boring and things like that. But to me, it's the planet, it's how it works. It's its history, you know, 4.5 billion years of dynamic change. And increasingly, it's what many of the biggest society challenges relate to the planet. You know, how, with this rising population, you know, how do we resource in terms of food and water? How do we resource humanity in terms of the infrastructure and the materials? How do we protect people in terms of disasters, etc.? And of course, climate change and ecological loss, which kind of dominates everything. So I think it's one of those subjects that sits in the shadows, but actually is really important center stage.
Can I ask you, why did you get interested about that? Did you suddenly look at a few rocks and saw, oh, this is interesting?
No, yeah, that's a good point, because a lot of geologists have mineral collection or fossil collection. I never had that. I guess I was always interested in exploration. I read lots of books around, you know, I had maps and exploration when I was a kid. And then when I was doing my geography at school, was 1980, was the Mount St. Helens eruption in that May. So on our TV screens was this volcano that is threatening to erupt and then blew apart and then it was devastation. And then I think that was a big part of me, because about a year later I had to make my decisions, and you know, geography and geology is what I took. So I think it was more already, unfortunately, the kind of violence of the earth, that as a young boy I was like, this is cool.
Okay. What is the status right now of geology, of studies?
So geology is having a bit of a hard time, actually. Across the world, doesn't matter if you're in the UK, bits of Europe, Australia, North America, numbers are going down usually in departments. And there's various, you know, everyone's kind of looking for reasons for that. Does it relate to some of the industry changes, or the price of metals and minerals, which drives a lot of the employment? There's the issue of the oil and gas, the fossil fuels, which a lot of geologists have found employment in, and now, of course, is on the wrong side of kind of economic growth. It's all about pollution and climate change. I think generally what it is a sense that geology, which always has its foot deeply in the past, you know, the people say that geology is about driving while you watch through your rear view mirror. You know, you're always looking back, everything's mm-hmm. back. And I think with all of the issues that we've got right now, people are looking for sciences that are looking forward rather than back. And so perhaps seeing geology as a 20th century science rather than a 21st century science. So I think that's what I'm trying to counter by really understanding what it is that people are, how they relate to geology and what it means to them, and then thinking about how do we switch that round so we show why an understanding of our planet is so critical for our future?
Okay. Well, one of the things that I can think that I myself depend a lot on geology is that everything that I carry with a battery or with a semiconductor depends a lot on geological resources.
Yeah, and this is a point that lots of people make, which is, you know, almost all our technology, I mean, half of this room is full of stuff that's been mined and dug up from the earth. And as you say, our mobile phones have got minerals and critical minerals in it. But that only goes so far in communicating, because most people actually don't care what's in their phone. They just want their phone to work. It's the same way as they don't understand how the engine of a car works. They just want the car to work. So sometimes we do fall into the trap of kind of finger wagging and saying, don't you know how important we are? Everything you have, you know, you relate to us. And it only goes so far, because people have to care about your subject. So it's not just about telling them information of how much stuff we do or whatever. It's actually about trying to make it connect to what they care about. And as I say, they might like their consumables and things like that, but they don't care necessarily what's in them. Most people don't anyway. So I think that's the trickier bit, is how do you make people care? And then you have to think, well, what are they interested in? And so connecting into what they're interested in is a a deeper, more meaningful way to try to ensure the importance of your subject, I think.
Can you give an example of this kind of connection? What would you look into a person's
interest? I think so. For example, a good thing is that towards the end of the 20th century, the big push was economic growth, right? So the idea was we should earn more money and more by us collectively getting richer. Yes, some people get very rich, but we would pull up the income levels across the world and well-being of people would improve. And then what we see really is two things that now into the, you know, early into the 2000s is one, huge social inequities around the planet. So it's not necessarily get any better. And so this notion then that us simply driving economic growth will automatically produce human well-being change, people having better lives, isn't there? So you then flip it and you think, well, how can geoscience help people have better lives? And there's lots of ways that either the way we think or the way we are skill sets, we can actually improve well-being. So stuff around disaster risk reduction and making homes safer. There's lots of issues around health, for example, the health of soils, the health of materials, the health of water, which are driven by geology. So I think what geology needs to do is say, it's not just about economic growth and creating materials that we can consume, because what we see, and this was the second aspect, is that hunt for economic growth has come at the expense of the planet. So we've now got climate change and ecological diversity because of that kind of rampant economic growth. So what I'm really setting out is a notion that we need to balance financial economic betterment, if you like, with general betterment of people's lives and thinking of how geology feeds that. So it's about making sure that we understand people's natural environments that they sit in and how to keep them intact, you know, the integrity of their natural environments. But it's also about trying to see things like mining, which is a big thing, or even energy, as a social plus, not just that brings in loads of money and then disappears off when the mine closes. How can you improve communities long term, plan for long term, as a result of resource exploitation? Because in Europe and elsewhere, people don't want holes to be dug in their backyard, even though we need a lot of these critical minerals for things that we would say. But equally, people aren't that keen on us going off to the Congo and digging it up and bringing it here as well. So, but they want stuff. So we're going to have to sort of balance that somehow. So I think if we can reframe the fact that geology allows us to find resources, and then the exploitation of those resources must happen in a way that's an economic and social plus, which means planning long term and not just going for profit maximization, but thinking about well-being maximization. So it's a change in framing more than a wholesale change. But it means that I think geology departments need to be setting their study of the planet in the context of this broader sustainability. You know, sustainability in the context of long-term well-being for all, intergenerational, inclusive, etc. Rather than just what geology has really been very powerful at, it's improved profit maximization for particular companies, corporate world. Mm-hmm. So I think that by chasing that aspiration, that mission around social well-being, geology will, by doing that, become more relevant to people's lives, and they'll be connecting with things they care about, and you know, it'll all be good. You know, that's the simple world in my head, anyway.
Okay, when you talk about exploration of resources, so like mining, for instance, for a common person, so I'm not a geologist, I like to think of myself as somebody science inclined, but it's difficult for me to, I know that resources are not infinite or unlimited, but I also don't know how much there is. And is that something that is, do you think is badly communicated? So for instance, I don't know how much lithium there is or how much cobalt or...
Well, I mean, the answer, there's two answers really. One answer is there's more than enough, there's enough. Because in terms of the physical presence of this, these materials, the particularly the upper part of the planet, the crust has got lots of it. The limiting factor is cost. Because as you go after smaller and smaller volumes, the cost of it goes up. And traditionally what happens if the cost of a commodity goes up, people then switch to some other one and you don't need it anymore. So lithium and cobalt and those kind of minerals are going to be absolutely critical for the low carbon future. The, you know, the lightest of metals, EV, electric vehicles, batteries, etc., is critical. And the demand for those is really high. So if you look at normal production rates, we have to vastly increase those production rates. So that will create a short-term problem of where to find them. But there, it is out there. That's when the next bit kicks in, which is morally, ethically, socially, is it acceptable to do in those, to dig in those places? Well, people, we call it the social license, where we get the social license to be able to do that. And that's why it's absolutely essential to bring the public on board in this process, because ultimately it's the public, it's society that will turn around to geologists to say, this is what we want you to do. We want you to go and find this stuff. Thank you, please, thank you, you know. So we'll go and find whatever we need or ask to find. So I think it is this business about, it's that macroeconomy, what do people want, that will then dictate the actual, how we exploit the physical resource that's in the rocks.
Okay, well, I'm Brazilian, and back in Brazil, in many years ago, during the gold rush, they managed to dig a whole mountain looking for gold. So there was a mountain called Serra Pelada, which doesn't exist anymore, because it was completely dug out. Wow. Are we still doing this kind of thing?
Yeah, unfortunately, places. I mean, I think that I discriminate between the big corporations, the big multinationals, and more of the national and local ones, and they have different behaviors. By and large, the big international that sit on the international stock market are you know, they've got headquarters in Europe, they've got shareholders. If you dig up a mountain or a terrible environmental policy, it affects your share price, it affects your profit margin. Now, it's not to say it doesn't happen. There was examples recently with Rio Tinto exploding Aboriginal caves in Australia. There was the incident in Brazil where the tailings dams failed, and there was a lot of people killed from that. But by and large, those companies are realizing that their own sustainability would be improved by actually genuinely changing the practice. I think at the local, the national and local level, that still has to factor in. So there still is a tension of getting it out at any price, bottom line, and trying to do it. And so, you know, in the States, there are still places where they have mountaintop, you know, for coal, which obviously is having a harder time. But there are still really bad practices where we basically industrialize the landscape to generate huge amounts of material. My sense from the industry as a whole is that they realize that that is not sustainable for their own reputation and purpose. So I think we'll see a change, whether it's happening fast enough. I'm sure people, viewers, will have different views on that. But I think there is change afoot, if you like.
Okay. And one last question. In 10, 20, or 50 years, where do you see geology and the education of geology?
10, 20, see, we're not used to looking ahead into the future, you see. Ask me, we look hundreds of millions of years back. I think it will be a subject that will be, we're already a very interdisciplinary subject. So geology is an amalgam of physics, chemistry, biology, maths, sprinkling of economics, sprinkling of social science. I think it will increasingly get more interdisciplinary because many of the issues that we're dealing with are already interconnected. You know, this wicked idea of unsolvable, you can't just tease them apart. And I think that's one of our biggest opportunities and offers, is that earth science is this very integrated, you know, we steal ideas from everywhere and build it into geology. So I think that'll be part of it. I think it will be very data driven, but I hope it will also be very people centered. That's what we've missed in the past, because we've been looking back, studying things that happened 10, 20, 100 million years ago, where people haven't really been actively involved. But I think the challenges of the future are fundamentally rooted in people and communities. And I think geoscientists will have to get more people centered and have people at the center stage in the work that they do. And And, you know, that'll be a change in the training and the mindset thing, but that's something I look forward to.
Thank you very much for this talk again.
Thank you.
Do you want to be a GeoHero as well? Then take the first step and click the subscribe button and then the bell button to always be the first to know when one of our GeoHeroes posts a new video.